so warm here. It's very nice coming from -1, -5 degrees. Yeah. So I would like to tell you about Calabi-Yau manifold. This is the sort of center of attention right now in string theory. So a lot of geometry, number theory, and of course string theory itself. They are in sort of a great activities. So I would like to tell you about what they are and why they are so interesting. And most of the physics stories are sort of I'm just touching upon briefly in connection with geometry and number theory. So if I have to give a mirror symmetry proper, I need another credit course.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I have about 5 lectures. So this week I'm giving you definitions of Calabi-Yaus and then the motivations, why we consider this from arithmetic point of view. And of course, geometry has to be in the background. And then in the second week, I'll get into more examples where we can prove some things. And then I would also like to discuss something like Gromov-Witten invariant generating functions and things like that. So there are 2 side of stories for arithmetic. First, I would do arithmetic modularity. So this is about concerning a Galois representation associated to this Calabi-Yau varieties. This is a Langrand program. Mostly conjecture, still mostly conjecture, and then geometric modularity. This is about the modularity of generating functions. There's a modularity of generating functions of Gromov-Witten invariant. And other invariant. So the Langrand program, this is you formulate in terms of L function or L series, which consists of counting number of rational points on Calabi-Yau manifold varieties. And then these guys, Gromov-Witten invariant and other invariant, these are in the families of Calabi-Yau manifold varieties, and trying to count number of curves. That's the generating function, counting curves. So this is a dimension 0 object. That's the constituent. These are the dimension 1 object. So these things will carry some modular properties, which is quite a surprise. And of course, mathematically, you can prove theorems. Some things will be modular. But we have no conceptual reason why this is happening. So this is one reason why we have to study physics. Reason should come from physics. Okay, so I'll start giving a definition, first of all, what that, and then also combining these things, I will discuss mirror symmetry. Calabi-Yau manifold. Okay, so that's the sort of rough plan of my lectures. And then, of course, you can ask any questions, interrupt me anytime if you want. to have more clarification. Okay? I would like to have a feedback as much as possible. Okay, so definition. Definition. What are Calabi-Yau varieties? What are they? So we consider a smooth projective smooth projective variety X, call it X. These are all defined over C, a complex manifold here over C of dimension. It's a complex dimension D. This is called, it's called a Calabi-Yau, it's called a Calabi-Yau. Calabi and Yau, these are two mathematicians. If two conditions are satisfied, if one, this is a Calabi-Yau condition one, so CY1, you look at HI, cohomology group HI, X structure, see here, X. Consider this cohomology group. This will be zero for every I living between zero and dimension, not including the end. And Calabi-Yau condition two, Calabi-Yau condition two, this is the canonical bundle. Bundle. Kappa of X is trivial. So Kx will be Ox. When these two conditions are satisfied, you call X a Calabi-Yau. Well, even this is a definition, but still you don't really know what Calabi-Yau manifold is. So I would like to introduce something called introduce Hodge numbers involving differential forms. C of differential forms are defined H sub ij of X to be the dimension of C of this Hodge groups, Hodge cohomology groups, omega xi. So omega x is the sheaf of differentials. This is the I form here. So this is defined I and j between 0 and d. Okay? So from the definition of this, the definition of Hodge cohomology groups, there is a duality. So these numbers, this is a dimension, so these are numbers. Hij of x will be hj of ix. Because cohomologically there is a complex conjugation, so this is by complex conjugation. Conjugation. And also there is something called the Sayre duality. So if you look at hij of x, this will be same as hd minus I. D is the dimension of the variety. And d minus j of x, this is called Sayre's duality. So these are the sort of first things you learn in algebraic geometry course for cohomology groups. So these are the Hodge numbers. You have Hodge numbers. And then once you have these Hodge numbers, you can define the Betti numbers. Betti numbers you can define as B sub K, case Betti numbers. Say case Betti number is going to be I plus J is equal to K, and you add all these Hodge numbers. For complex varieties, smooth complex varieties, this is true. This is called the Hodge decomposition. So smooth projective varieties, this is true. But if you go to singular ones, so characteristic P, this equality may break down. But in this case, it is true. And you have the Euler characteristic. Okay, so the Euler character, usually E sub X, you just take alternating sum K equals 0 to 2D, I equals 0 to 2D minus and I beat the IX. So associated to this Calabi-Yau variety, you'll have all this numerical invariant. So you will see right away. So digression about the definition is that Calabi-Yau condition one. This is equivalent to say that h I zero of x, h zero I of x. This is zero for every I between 0 and D. That's Calabi-Yau condition 1. That's the equivalence here. Calabi-Yau condition 2, this is only a sufficient condition. It implies, Calabi-Yau condition 2 implies that h d0 of x, by duality, this is h0d of x. So if you do this, this is going to be a dimension of C, H0, X, omega XD. But this is a canonical bundle. So this is nothing but the dimension of C, H0, X, kappa of X. Calabi-Yau condition 2 says that this guy is trivial. So this is going to be a dimension of C, H0, X or X, so this is 1. So this number is called the geometric genus. This number is defined as P sub GX, called the geometric genus. So that's the Calabi-Yau manifold. So Calabi-Yau varieties, so all this H, Hodge numbers, these little guy vanishes, and then now the top HD0, okay, geometric genus is 1. Those are the Calabi-Yau varieties. Okay, so let's see some examples. Examples of Calabi-Yau varieties. So if dimension is 1, what kind of Hodge numbers will appear? Okay, Hodge numbers, I'll just put together all Hodge numbers to make something called Hodge diamond. Hodge diamond of X is H00, H10, H01, H11. So that's your diamond here. And the duality says that you can identify this holding here along this line. It will be the same. And then another complex conjugation and say a duality. So this Hodge diamond is, now Calabi-Yau, this guy H00 is always 1. H10, that's the Calabi-Yau condition 1. No, not Calabi-Yau. Calabi-Yau condition 1 is empty here, vacuous. There is no integer between 0 and 1. So this is, so H10, this is the Calabi-Yau condition 2. So that is 1. So that's 1, 1. So that's your Hodge diamond. Now, Betti numbers are obtained by adding all Hodge numbers horizontally. So if you add this, B0 is equal to 1. if you add this horizontally, B1 is equal to 2. And then B2 is equal to 1. If you take out the netting sum, Euler characteristic is 0. So this numerical characterization, characterized so dimension 1. Dimension 1, Calabi-Yau, are elliptic curves. Okay. So yeah, elliptic curves, everybody knows about this. So I'll give you a couple of examples. So elliptic curves, cubics in P2. These are typical examples of elliptic curves. And then you can take double cover y squared is equal to f3 of x. F3 is a cubic degree 3 cubic in x. Right? So when we want to consider elliptic curves over Q, you may write this as x cubed plus ax plus b, where a and b are rational numbers, and then 4a cubed plus 27b squared, it's not there, call it delta. So that's the elliptic curves. These are elliptic curves. Now, so if d equal 2, what happens? Dimension 2, Calabi-Yau. Hodge diamond, how many Hodge numbers are there? Hodge diamond of x is, you take h00, h10, h01, h20, h11, h02, h21, h12, h22. So that's your diamond here. And of course, there is a duality here as before. So now what Calabi-Yau condition says, H00 is 1. Calabi-Yau condition 1 says that this is 0. This is 0. And Calabi-Yau condition 2 says that this is 1. So you have a 0, 1. 0, 1, 1. So this, I haven't put anything here yet. Okay, but so if you calculate Betti numbers, B0 is 1, B1 is 0, B2 is something like a 2 plus some alpha, say call alpha.
Yeah,
0. Hmm? Oh, sorry, 0. And B3 is 0. And B4 is 1. So the Euler characteristic is going to be, you take alternating sums, so you'll get 2 plus 4 plus alpha. What is this alpha? Well, this is for the Max Netter. Max Netter, it's not the Emmy Netter, Emmy Netter's father. Max Netter formula says that Euler characteristic of OX. This is H00 minus H10 plus H20. For in this case, this is 0. One minus 0 plus 1. This is 2. But this is equal to, that's the Max Netter says that this is C1 squared plus C2 divided by 12. These are Chan numbers. And then for K3, it's Chan numbers, C1 is equal to 0, and C2 is equal to the Euler characteristic. Mm. Okay, so if you solve this for C2, so then now if you solve this, so C1 squares from here, it follows that C1 squares plus C2 is equal to 24. This one was zero. C2 is the 4 plus alpha, which is 4 plus alpha. Therefore, alpha is equal to 20. So you put 20 here. Mm-hmm. And these are called K3 surfaces. So dimension 2, Calabi-Yau varieties are K3 surfaces. K3, K stand for initial of three great mathematicians involved developing this theory for K3s. So K3 stand for Kumma, Kera, and Kodaira. So these K3 surfaces, well, this was named by Andre Weil in Himalayas. They have something called K2 peaks. It's quite difficult to conquer. K3 is more difficult. But it's extremely interesting surface. So examples of K3s, so cortex. We had for dimension one, Calabi-Yau, you had cubics, cortex. So cortex in P3. Okay, degree four surfaces in P3. That's all defined K3s. And the generalization of this, the double cover of this is the double cover, double sextics. So you will take something like W squares is equal to F of X, Y, Z, and this is degree six. If six is a homogeneous, polynomial of degree six. Okay, and also because you can look at fibers, what kind of fibers would occur on this K3, so you may have elliptic K3 surfaces. So I gave you this equation, but now you can consider y squared z is equal to x cubed plus a sub t xz squared plus b sub t z cubed. So a sub t and b sub t are now polynomials in parameter t satisfying these discriminant conditions. So for good T, there will be just elliptic curves. So these are called fibers. Okay. So these are the examples of K3 surfaces. I'll come back to this later. And also Kumma, why Kumma's name is here, Kumma surfaces. So these are, you take abelian surface, and then abelian surface, you have an involution. So if you involution, take a double cover of this abelian surface, And that was involution will give you a two torsion point, so it blow them up. So these are case three surfaces, blow up. All right. So now if you go to dimension three, dimension three, the hot diamond, Calabi-Yau, this Calabi-Yau, so the hot diamond. Of x is now h0 0 h1 0 h0 1 h, oh I cannot write it here. Which diamond is
h10 0 h0 0 h10 0 h10 1 h20 h11 h02 h30 h21 h12 h03 h31 h22 h13 h23 h33.
So that's your diamond here. So there is a duality here. So now, diamond here is Calabi-Yau condition says that these two guys will be zero. That's the Calabi-Yau condition one. And this guy is one, condition two. So you get 1 0 0 1 0 0 1. Well, H11, we don't know what it is. H21, H12, 0, H22, 0, 0, 0, 1. That's your diamond. So because of the duality here, these two numbers are the same. H11 and H22 are the same. Okay? Now, so the Betti numbers, B0 is 1, B1 is 0, B2 is H11, B3 is a twice of 1 plus H21, B4 is 0, H22, B5 is 0, and B6 is 1. So if you take alternating sums, Euler characteristic is going to be a twice of H11 minus H21. Okay, so for dimension one, Euler characteristic was zero. For dimension two, Calabi-Yau's Euler characteristic was 24, the fixed constant. If you go to dimension three, Euler characteristic is not a fixed constant. Okay, so the question here is, is of x Euler characteristic could be bounded? Is there some fixed constant which bounds the Euler characteristic? Okay, so physicists, string theorists, they say this is bounded because they want theoretic model for the universe should be finite, only finitely many types. That depend on the boundedness or your characteristic. But mathematicians do not believe it. So it's still open. Okay, so the examples of Calabi-Yau three, or these are called Calabi-Yau threefold, And string theory happens here in the category of Calabi-Yau threefold. So the examples of Calabi-Yau threefold, so along this line here, it is for dimension one, we had cubic, and then the double curve of cubic curve, so quartic, and the double sextics. So here you get quintics in P4. Quintics in P4. And like a double cover of degree six surface here, curve here. So in this case, double octics. So you can write that T squares is equal to F8 X, Y, Z, W. So you over degree eight surface, you take a double cover of that. This will give you a Calabi-Yau threefold, where F8 are homogeneous. Homogeneous degree eight polynomial. And of course, you can also get elliptic Calabi-Yaus, and then elliptic Calabi-Yaus. So you can define this the same equation. So now this AT and BT are now depending on two parameters, okay, over surfaces. And when it comes to this Calabi-Yau threefold, it's something called the toric Calabi-Yaus. Toric geometry is coming in, and using combinatorics, polytopes, reflexive polytopes, toric Calabi-Yaus. There are a lot, so we have lots of Calabi-Yau threefold. And that's where we want to do physics stuff, and then this is what the mirror symmetry about for Calabi-Yau's threefold physics part is the so mirror symmetry conjecture. This is something called topological. It's mirror symmetry. This is a conjecture. In many cases, it has been established. So this says that given a Calabi-Yau threefold X. These are all over C. There is a family. It's not a one-to-one correspondence. It's family of Calabi-Yau. Oh yeah, maybe I should mention Calabi-Yau threefold X with hot numbers. So you have two unknown Hodge numbers, H11 of X, H21 of X. Okay. So topological mirror symmetry claims that there is a family. Of Calabi-Yau threefold X. X check. Maybe I would X hat. such that with H11 of X check is the H21 of the original Calabi-Yau, and H21 of X hat is the H11 of X. So that if you calculate the Euler characteristic of the mirror, this, because this H11 and H21 will interchange, switches, so it changes sign. So that's the topological mirror symmetry conjecture. So we have it's every day this list of this Calabi-Yau threefold and its mirror partners. They are it's always increasing, just dependent. But we have about 600 million Calabi-Yaus by toric construction. This is a combinatorics, so it's easy to put in the computer and then produce all this. And then about 660,000 different H11 of X, H21 of X, of course. So I need a projector at this point. Okay, so the horizontal this axis is the Euler characteristic, and the vertical one is the H11 plus H21. Okay, so they plotted all these Hodge numbers, pairs of Hodge numbers, and then they got this. Okay, if mirror symmetry is true, Euler characteristic will change the sign. So you also should have a Calabi-Yau on this side. That's the mirror symmetry conjecture. They should have this side as well. Okay. So quintics mirror has the Euler characteristic 200, so somewhere around here. So it should come in this side. Okay, so this is the mirror symmetry. So for many cases, this has been established. And this list is increasing day by day. So dimension one case. This is by Wiles, and then his former student, his disciples and followers. And Wiles got the Abel Prize this year. Yeah, for this achievement. Okay, so the arithmetic. Modularity. So this is the arithmetic modularity. So ala Langrands. So the motivation, the motivating result came from elliptic curves. So dimension one. Okay, so this is a virus, and his company. It started at 1994, but then finally something like 2001 or 2002, the complete proof is there. So in the last 25 years, less than 25, every elliptic curve E defined over Q is modular. So that's the biggest result in the last century, end of last century. And then statement, exact statement involves something like L-Fang L-series, which consists of pointing, point counting of a finite field. So that is, more precisely, there is a modular form F of weight 2. 2 is a d plus 1 on gamma 0 of n. I'll explain all these things in detail. This is just I'm giving you a motivation to go on to higher dimensional cases for some n. Such that L function of ES will coincide with the, that's the statement of the, and in fact, you have to bring in something called the Galois representations to get to this. So this is the motivation. So can you do this for Calabi-Yau varieties of dimension 2 and Calabi-Yau varieties of dimension 3 defined over Q? So I want to define what L series is cooked up and then what the modular forms are. If you know everything about that, I'll skip this part. Okay. Okay, so I'll define definition of L series. So a general setting is that now consider Calabi-Yau varieties variety X defined over Q.
Can it be defined over Q? Does that have any physical meaning?
Defined over Q, yeah, so you have, if you want to go to previous this physics stuff, you have to go to C, tensor with C, and consider all invariant there. So if it's defined over Q, definitely you can define over C.
Yeah, but does it, do they have special meaning or special
No, because in order to do arithmetic mirror symmetry, we have to have something defined over Q, and how to count number points, how to count number of curves over Q. So we try to understand mirror symmetry first, starting with this number theoretic setting. Okay, so Witten was asking me when I gave this lecture, maybe it doesn't have anything to do with physics part. So this is the sort of a project I'm working on it, how to tie up with the, yes?
Because you want to compare the A theory and the B theory.
That's right, A model and B model, right? So you have to construct the B model side, but then if you defined over Q, Calabi-Yau is defined over Q, B model family, maybe you can also define the over Q with parameter attached to it. And many examples, I gave you about 600 million toric examples, they are all defined over Z. It's hypersurface. Complete intersection hypersurfaces, so they are all defined even over Z. Okay, so you can do that. So defined over Q, what does this mean? This means that i.e. X is defined by the vanishing of a finite number of polynomial equations, polynomials with coefficient in Q. And if you so this is and if you tensor this over Q, this is our Calabi-Yau. I defined the Calabi-Yau manifold over C, right? So it's if tensor or if you tensor with C, then becoming a Calabi-Yau manifold. Okay, it's a Calabi-Yau. So in many Calabi-Yau, so many cases, starting out with defining equations, many of them are hypersurfaces or complete intersections, and you do construct Calabi-Yaus and compute this geometric invariant going to C.
Just to complete the question of Javier, if the Calabi-Yau variant is not defined over Q, then anyway it would be defined over some extension.
Yes. Oh, I'm just doing it simplicity for the sake of simplicity over Q. You can do over number field. Okay. So because we are starting with finite number polynomials having coefficient in Q, getting rid of denominators, you may assume that assume that the coefficient are in Z in the ring, just inverting one some number here. You may do that. Okay, so now in order to do arithmetic, in order to define the Langrand stuff, we will define, we'll pick. So this is something physicists are quite for physicists it's quite hard to understand now going to finite field. This is because they have no sort of concept in physics world what finite field is. Mm-hmm. So pick a prime p, prime number p, which does not divide m. P and M are relatively prime. So, what we'll do is, what we can do is now, what we are over here. So then now we'll say that it's because if P is not dividing M and we have this polynomial equations, you can reduce this equation's modulo P, right? So let X of P is the X modulo P. So these guys are all defined over finite field of P element. So if X of P is smooth over FP bar, you say that this P is a good prime. P is called a good prime. And if not, if introducing singularities, then otherwise it's a bad. Okay, so now for these good primes, now you are in the world of finite field. So you have a Frobenius morphism induced by piece power map. Okay, so definition is that for a good prime P. We can count the number of rational points. Because it's a finite field, there are only finitely many solutions, so you can count them. So the local or congruent zeta function of X P is defined by theta sub P X T, pick T is an indeterminate. This is a generating function counting number of rational points, exponential k equal 1 to infinity, number of rational points defined over x over finite field with p to the k element divided by k t to the k. This is the generating function counting number of rational points. This is very familiar to physicists, counting things and then making a generating function. So this is a polynomial in Q of t. Power series in Q of t. Where t is, x is a Calabi-Yau, x is a Calabi-Yau. Okay? Where t is non-indeterminate. So this is the counting. So this is the sort of common denominator with the string theorists. They are interested in counting something. You can count a number of rational points for each finite field, Fp, Fp squares, but there are still infinitely many, right? So this is a definition which is not to tell you how to actually determine this thing. So what you really need is a linear algebra. Linear algebra data, which will let you compute this guy. So this is something very conjectured. There should be some linear algebraic data called very cohomology, which will enable you to determine this guy. Yes?
From the physics side, is that supposed to be a partition function?
It should be.
For what theory?
Well, partition function of what? We don't know.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so so Weyl cohomology theory, so the Weyl cohomology. Okay, this part of the lecture is for physicists. Usually when I give this lecture, this is a part I have to give to them. So Weyl cohomology, because in the physics world, the counting generating functions, and partition functions, they have no cohomology theory to describe these things. So that's their project. They have to work on the cohomology theory. But in this setting, we have something called Weyl cohomology, which is, cohomology, and then what Weyl conjecture says, which is now a theorem, saying that this guy, the rationality result. So that P of XT, this is some kind of rational function, not just a power series. That P X P of T divided QP of T, this is where PP and QP are polynomials with integer coefficient. So this is it's a rational function, rational. Rational function. A priori, this was just a power series, but then it's a rational function. And there is something called functional equations. Functional equation, which relate that P of X 1 over p to the dt. So d is the dimension, Calabi-Yau variety of dimension d. So if you compare this zeta function together with zp of xt, this will be something like plus or minus p of d over 2, and then t of Euler characteristic. These two are somehow done by Dvorak in the periodic method, but this guy, the Riemann hypothesis. This is done by Dirin, because this says that the Zp of xt, it's a rational function, what these guys are. So p1 xt, p2d minus 1 xt, p0 xt, p of 2d xt, where, so this guy, this upstairs is the P of P, and downstairs is a Q of Q P of T. All right, so we are. Where P of I x t, this is a polynomial with integer coefficient, and the degree of P I is the Betchi number, ith Betchi number. And so these guys has integer coefficient. So if you decompose this, if you go to the algebraic closure and decompose into the product of linear factors, each one of them, j equal 1 to bi of x, 1 minus alpha ij of t, if you do, then alpha ij of t, these are algebraic integers, and the complex absolute value is p of I over 2. That's the Riemann hypothesis. That was the proof by Dirin.
This part about Bell cohomology and all the rest, is independent of X being a Calabi-Yau.
Yeah, this is for arbitrary algebraic varieties, smooth algebraic varieties over finite field. Yeah. So you see, now you will see there is some kind of finite dimensional object behind it. Right, because each one of these guys has dimension bi. So this is the Grothendieck idea. His memorial workshop is coming. So Grothendieck idea, this is the erratic et al. Cohomology. That's the linear algebraic data you need to express all this gadget. So what L is, L is a prime. L is a prime, different from P. And for this, you associate to this erratic et al. Cohomology is associated to for the erratic et al. Cohomology. Associate to xp bar. This is xp going to the closure here. Or instead of this, you may take x bar. This is x tensor over q bar. These are all algebraic things at erratic associated to certain QL vector spaces. Okay, so this is called etal I, XP bar QL, or HI etal X bar QL. But then Grothendieck shows that the specialization theorem gives you the isomorphism between the two. So when you are looking at the over finite field, you have the Frobenius morphism induced by the piece power map. So you can use those and lift that to here and characterize everything in terms of this Frobenius. That's the idea. So so let okay, and then it's the vector spaces, and then the vector spaces, if you HI etal X bar QL, if you tensor with C, you get back the HI usual complex singular cohomology. And this one has dimension BI. Right? These are the ones we started out with. But etal cohomology is finer theory using torsion point. So dimension of QL vector space of HI etal X bar QL is a BI of X. That's the vector space. That's the linear algebra. Now we have, now let flop P be the Frobenius morphism on X induced by the piece power map on XP induced by the piece power map. And this will lift, which lift to P star, oops, P star on HI etal X bar QL. So now you have the linear operator here. So now you take the characteristic polynomial of this guy acting on HI etal X bar QL, characteristic polynomial, so that you don't have to worry about choice of basis. So this guy is nothing but your PI XT, which appears there.
This QL is which kind of a field?
Erratic.
So
erratic rationals, completion of, yeah. Well, usually you call it QP, but I'm calling it L. Yeah. So this is exactly what describes entire thing. So now what? So some of the all this modularity conjecture or Langrand philosophy, they are formulated in terms of Galois representations. So where the Galois group will come in here. So, now let G will be the absolute Galois group. Maybe I should use German G. Be the Q bar over Q. Be the absolute Galois group. Okay, then Then, of course, our Calabi-Yau variety X is defined over Q, so this guy would act on our Calabi-Yau. Galois group, I mean. So the so in particular, this vector space you can also introduce this Galois group act on HI et al X bar QL in this vector space as well. Okay, so the action will be in here. So this is not just a QL vector space, but it's a G module, Galois module. So this is the very finer part coming into this arithmetic side. This you don't see this at all if you are working over C. So then you have the Galois representation rho L I X, the absolute Galois group into G L H I et al X bar Q L. This be the Galois representation, be the natural Galois representation. So then the definition of the L series here is the L series. L sub IXS will be defined by L series going through the set R cohomology, X bar QL. So I already told you what this is. If you go to the L series, that's the characteristic polynomial of the Frobenius. So this is the factor. This is the factor corresponding to but primes. And then P, a good prime. And P is different from L, and then you'll get this guy here. L, this is the polynomial. P, I, P to G minus S minus 1, times the factor corresponding to L equal P. So for this guy, you have to use a different cohomology theory, like a crystalline cohomology, periodic cohomology theory. But this is a way to describe the L series appeared in the formulation of elliptic curve situation. But with this definition, you can do for all Calabi-Yaus for any algebraic varieties. So so L of XS is the L of D excess. This is the one what we really want to understand. So the modularity of L function. Now, locally, if you give a prime, locally, we can do this, right? Characteristic polynomial. So local factor will be determined. But there are infinitely many primes. So your work will never be done. So the modularity question, Langrand philosophy, is that there is the L series. L series defined like that, or in the other formulations, the Galois representations of X, of Calabi-Yau. This is not just for Calabi-Yau, but then I'm formulating for Calabi-Yau X defined over Q is determined by a modular form or automorphic. That's the philosophy. Okay, so you see from the way L function is cooked up, if you know the local, you know the local things, but we need some global function. We'll determine the whole thing. It doesn't depend on prime P. That's the Langrand philosophy. So it's really, really sort of impossible task.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So the Frobenius morphism is something which is from characteristic P.
P.
And then, so you're saying there that it leads to this...
some morphism.
This X bar
yes.
thing. And then over there in the first line, it says that when you tensor with C, it corresponds to the usual
cohomology, yeah.
So this automorphism of the usual cohomology, does it preserve the Hodge structure of HI? Some linear map you're obtaining from arithmetic.
Yes.
But this HI, it has Hodge decomposition.
Hodge decomposition, yes, yes. So well, complex conjugation is there, so we know how it interacts with complex conjugation.
Right, but this Frobenius map is a map of period P. The Frobenius morphism is a finite morphism.
At this stage it's a Frobenius piece power map, right? So downstairs it's induced by just x goes to x to the p, and leaving coefficient invariant. That's the map. But then you can lift this to characteristic P, Q. There are many of them where reduced modulo P it coincides with downstairs. That's the lifting here. But this is a linear map acting on this vector space.
This lift is a canonical lift? Or
no, by no means it's canonical. There may be lots.
So my question preserving the Hodge structure?
Yeah, maybe not. Hodge decomposition is preserved.
Hodge decomposition is preserved.
Yeah. Because there's some.
And so, I mean, you, by the way you're putting this, everything is like embedded in a projective space. So you also have this Lefschetz decomposition.
Of course. So I have a Lefschetz. So how do you relate finite? So I should put in somewhere here. So where do I put in? There is also the Lefschetz fixed point formula. Counting number of rational points over FP, this is the same as taking the trace, alternating sum minus 1 to the k equals 0 to 2d, trace of Frobenius P star acting on HI et al. X bar QL. Okay. So these are all, you know, all this et al. Bringing in et al. Cohomology and passing all this to more sort of algebraic finer cohomology theory is all due to Grothendieck. Only thing he couldn't finish was the Riemann hypothesis. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there is also, because this will relate. Right, to the zeta function and all that. So this whole thing, Grothendieck's idea, is just fantastic. It's a sort of alien kind of ideas, I think. All right, so okay, so that's that. So the what kind of things can you prove bringing in these machineries? So what for?
Fifteen minutes.
Well,
10, 12 minutes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, so the recent result, because I want to give you a sort of really the mechanism of how to prove the dimension one case, then that will carry over to dimension two and dimension three. Idea will be the same, more or less. Okay. So recent result. Recent meaning 1995 for on modularity. So the first case was the equal one, but I should mention this modular forms, it's the same group.
Same modular
group. So we won't have to say about modular groups, modular forms. You are familiar with that?
No.
Mm-hmm.
Let's assume for the time being that yes.
Okay, so maybe I'll start. I already stated the formulation for D equal 1. So D equal 1, so E is non-elliptic curve. I'll repeat this in the next lecture because I cannot finish. Elliptic curve, E over Q. And L series, now you know what L series is. I already told you how it's defined. So it's a factor corresponding to the bad primes. And then P is a good prime. That means doesn't divide the discriminant. And then you get the 1 minus, so P1 of PTG minus S inverse. That's the way we defined L series here. So the P1 of T is 1 minus so what is this?
It's not QT?
No. 1 minus, I'll call it that. P1 of t is the determinant of 1 minus flop p star t acting on h1 e ql. This is just two-dimensional, so ql, two-dimensional. So this is just a 2x2 matrix. So you express this as a 2x2 matrix, so one, then you take a determinant. So what you get is 1 minus trace of flop p star t, and then you get the determinant of this guy is a p t squares. That's your characteristic polynomial. Now you have the Lefschitz fixed point formula here. So the number of rational point e sub fp is going to be a 1 minus trace of flop p star plus p. Because these guys are h0, right? The one dimensional. And these guys are one-dimensional, but you have a Poincaré variety. So this the trace here. So that's the it's a trace, and then a number of rational points are related with this formula. Trace of FP star is going to be a 1 plus P minus number of rational points. So the L function is cooked up. L function is cooked up just counting number of rational points. So the L series is involving this consists of counting number of rational points on FP on E over FP, and L series of modular form of weight 2. These guys should be equal. Equality is established at this level, 1 plus P minus E of FP. It's the piece coefficient. But this, this is too sketchy. So I'll start to repeat from this part in the next lecture, starting with the definition of modular groups and modular forms, and we'll state this starting with this result, and then we try to extend this result to K3 surfaces for dimension 2, and the Calabi-Yau threefold in dimension 3. When this vector spaces, associated vector spaces, is two-dimensional. It not always happens like that, but we will choose those cases and then we can establish modularity for those. Yeah. So that will be next lecture.